It's showtime.
Down to business. I got my wild cherry diet Pepsi, and I got my blackjack gum here, and I got that feeling. Yeah, that familiar feeling that something rank is going down out there.
Welcome to the gutter. Everyone ends up here eventually. It is only a matter of time. The tree of woe did not grow to such size overnight, nor did this show come about with anything less than a great deal of hard work. And I hope it lives up to what I anticipate it to be for both you as the live viewing audience and those of you tuning in after the fact. I remain your dutiful host, Aldous, striving each week with the gutter to bring you solid, entertaining, comic-centric, for the most part, episodes that both inform and entertain. My only guide on this journey, unfortunately one that you can sometimes hear, is with us again tonight for the second episode in a row following a brief absence. The co-host of co-hosts, the man, the myth, the legend in Boston restaurant review circles, if ever so briefly, JP. JP, how are we doing this evening?
I am doing well. Can we keep that intro music?
Yeah, we certainly can.
Yeah, the upbeat fantasy techno. I dig it.
You like that? That for the intro was kind of dedicated just to this one, but we'll see what we can do. I try to kind of like tailor it to whatever vibe we're kind of going over each evening. But we could see what we could do there.
Yeah, just make something better next week.
Yeah, I'll talk to editorial tomorrow and see what we can do. And joining us as a special guest, a name that is not recognized by near enough in this comic niche of the series of tubes we call our corner of the internet. Her first time on our particular version of the gutter. I don't know if she's been to the gutter before or not. Welcome the one, the only, Kayla. Kayla, thank you for joining us for what I'm sure promises to be the first of many appearances based on a lot of our conversations recently. How are you doing tonight?
I'm great. I'm excited to be here. It's really weird to not be in the chat and not be watching, to be participating. So I'm a little nervous.
I'm sure our numbers will suffer appropriately because you're not in the chat, given our general viewership is measured in the teens. So fantastic. You know what? It wouldn't be a gutter if we didn't spend a little bit of time turning over to our glorious chat and saying hi to see who's joined us. First up on the docket, we've got Odin Dasko. Very much looking forward to this installment of The Gutter. Well, thank you so much for joining us, my friends. Arrogant Ape says, hear me out, Hollywood. The Shabbage Schlong of Bonan, the tale of horrors and horacy. I'm sure there is already. If there isn't, I would be shocked if that has not already been done. We've got Scarlet Fever joining us. Great to see Scarlet Fever. Hojo stayed awake for this one. Hojo will be on an upcoming episode here at the end of April. Mad Cave will be releasing their version of Dick Tracy. I hold that it will be a sad, pathetic imitation of Chester Gould's wonderful character. I don't know Holjo's opinion, but we'll find out in that episode with what Mad Cave is able to produce. Snuggy Jr. has joined us. Great to see Snuggy Jr. Bretzky the Great. Awesome. Great to see you, my friend. Henry Bemis, once again, here to join us. H is for Heretic as well. Great to see you, my friend. Michael Dejarin's awesome, man. Look at all those thumbs up. Hell yeah. And scrolling down through the chat here, we got everybody saying hi to each other. And Citizen Ronan has joined us. If you're not following Citizen Ronan on either Instagram or Twitter, make sure you do so. He's got some awesome painting skills that he's been displaying on the regular. Quiet Red Media has joined us as well. You should also be following Quiet Red. He's got some awesome stuff coming down the pipes. Arrogant Ape says, the fantasy techno made me wish I was a fat, greasy emperor shouting from the balcony of a coliseum. Why isn't he dead? Kill him! Okay. Hostman's Lounge has joined us. Blessed Good Friday and Happy Easter, folks. Indeed, he is risen, my friend. Thank you so much for your comment. That's appreciated. Gooch from Diabolical. That's a exchange right there, going from Hostman's Easter greetings to the Gooch of Diabolical Soul Studios. But you know what? We welcome all of our friends, and great to see you. Gooch is here apparently just to support Queen Kayla. He doesn't give a shit about JP or myself. Thank you. I think. Not sure on that one. But yeah. With all that being said, tonight on The Gutter, know, my friends, that between the years when the oceans drank Atlantis and the gleaming cities and the years of the rise of the songs of Arius, there was an age undreamed of, when shaking kingdoms lay across the world like blue mantles beneath the stars. Numidia, Ophir, Bertharia, Hyperborea, Zamora with its dark-haired women and towers of spider-haunted mystery. Zingara with its chivalry, Koth, that bordered on the pastoral lands of Shem, Stygia, with its shadow-guarded tombs, Herinkia, whose riders wore steel and silk and gold. But the proudest kingdom in the world was Aquilonia, reigning supreme in the dreaming west. Hither came Conan, the Cimmerian, black-haired, sullen-eyed, sword in hand, a thief, a reaver, a slayer, with gigantic melancholies and gigantic mirth, to tread the jeweled thrones of the earth under his sandaled feet. Quoted from the Numidia Chronicles, obviously, the famous selection from the fictional Hyborian scribes, preceding none other than Robert E. Howard's first foray into the land that we will be diving into tonight, that of the Phoenix and the Sword from Weird Tales magazine. Now, that particular issue, for those of you that aren't familiar, has been mentioned a few times here, both for its its general reverence within the pulp world, as well as its value, which exceeded over $10,000. Here is the actual issue in and of itself. The first and only time you will see Robert E. Howard writing a Conan book in Weird Tales, and his name does not appear on the cover at all. But that was not the end of it, as we are all well aware. In the next issue of Weird Tales came the second Conan tale, and the first, arguably, true Conan tale, as the previously mentioned, was a reworking of an existing Kull story by Robert E. Howard. And so in January of 1933 came this, and there, in the upper right-hand corner, you see Robert E. Howard's name proudly displayed. But it was not until March of that same year that the third installment, and the most magical, by my own opinion, debuted. The Tower of the Elephant is the first story that Conan is not a king or even a leader. He is a young man. And it was originally described in the pages of Weird Tales as a strange, blood-freezing story of an idol that wept on its throne and a vibrant, valiant barbarian from the fringes of elder civilization. Here is the table of contents where you can clearly see Tower of an Elephant right there from pages 306 to 322. The first page within that Weird Tales from March of 1933 looked like this. And how can you not love this? This is everything that pulp is meant to be. It is everything that Robert E. Howard's work stands for. So Conan here, like I said, is a young man. Perhaps in his late teens or his early 20s, depending on which chronology you use. I myself subscribe to I only reference the Robert E. Howard stories. There's a couple Sprague de Camp stories I like. There's a couple other ones from some other authors that I like. But man, when it comes down to it, let's just focus on the Robert E. Howard stuff. That's the core here. And this is the third tale. Like I said, the second true Conan tale, the first where he's not in a leadership role. He's a young man here. He's inexperienced. And you see that very early on in the story as we will be getting into it. But we will not be talking about that particular story directly. Instead, we will be discussing Savage Sword of Conan, issue number 24 from November of 1977. But this, while this is an excellent adaptation, was not the first adaptation. Previously, in Conan the Barbarian, in April of 1971, issue 4, Roy Thomas also did an adaptation. However, it wasn't quite what he wanted to do. He wasn't able to give it the attention or the detail that he was looking forward to. And so when Savage Sword of Conan launched, he had multiple avenues at his disposal. One, he finally had the artist that he originally wanted for the Conan the Barbarian run initially, which is John Buscema. Two, he actually had more pages to dedicate to the story. And third, the proverbial quote-unquote cuffs were off for what he would be allowed to run with, for Savage Sword was a magazine and was not beholden to the strict limits of what was allowed in comics. He had more leniency. And in fact, before we get into that, I wanted to get some first impressions here, because there is an editor's note that actually addresses that in this very issue of Savage Sword. And so I guess I'm going to go first to our special guest, Kayla. Kayla, what, from a 500-foot view of this book, what does this book mean to you?
What does it mean to me? Well, let me just talk about my week, because I've reread all three versions of this that I own, which is the original Robert E. Howard's story, which is underneath 100 pages, and then the Barry Windsor Smith, the Marvel Roy Thomas version, which is not as expository, I should say. And then Savage Sword 24 here, which we're talking about tonight. And this is basically the perfect combination that really allows the reader to gain insight into Conan. And as well as it demonstrates the proper way to execute someone else's property. In the editorial note, I think you're referring to in the front where Roy Thomas is listed as the editor. And then at the bottom, it's Robert E. Howard as the soul and inspiration. This story, I think for me, after rereading it so much, it definitely now is in my top of Conan stories. It's really hard for me not to to honestly like be like, oh, Queen of the Black Coast, because that was the first one I read. And that will always be my favorite because of that. Sorry, sentimental thing. But as far as really showing who Conan is as a character, when people tend to think about Conan, they think of him being as a one-dimensional character. In this story here, you learn that he is not. So, yeah. I don't think that answered your question, but that's what I had to say. So,
all right. And before we dive in, JP, do you have what's your general overview of this after having read it? And is this your first foray into Conan, or have you had background in Conan before this?
No, that's a loud truck. I didn't really have a lot of exposure to Conan, but I think he was in the Amazon with my mom when she was researching spiders right before she died.
I'm sorry. I don't know if I should laugh.
Oh, no, that was the Madam Web dialogue meme. That was an actual line from that movie. Sorry, I was making a joke. Yeah, so I've read some things with us in a similar kind of genre and motif, and I found most of them to just be really, really boring. But I feel like, yeah, this was, I started to get it a little bit. It has a kind of, the writing particularly, like the prose writing, really just kind of carried me through in a way. And I'll be interested to hear what both of your thoughts are in terms of, how do I put this? Books that are relying on narrative balloons over just straight dialogue, and how you feel about a book that is like leaning more or is really light on the dialogue, how you both feel about that.
Well, I think the most important thing leading into this is understanding that, yeah, I mean, there are people that their first experience or first exposure to this story was Conan the Barbarian number 4 from 71, like I mentioned. There are other people that their first exposure to this story was The Savage Sword of Conan number 24, which is the one we're going to be talking about. There are even more people that were exposed by the Weird Tales story, the original short story.
Well, maybe exposed. Not in
this. Yeah, I fucking YouTube, man. Like I can't show a cover from a magazine that was on the stands in 1933. I have to cover it up to avoid it. Talk about censorship. You know, screw the Comics Code Authority. This is the real problem. Not this exact issue. Not like people have access to the Weird Tales, but that story has been reprinted time and time and time again in multiple Conan collections. And arguably, and people, there's discussion boards on discussion boards on when did Conan take off, right? Conan's always been popular, as shown by his prevalence of the stories. Weird Tales at one point was actually asking Robert E. Howard to write more Conan stories. That's how popular he was. Now, does the popularity booms and then it ebbs, as all things do, and then the comics take off in the early 70s. But all between then, between the early 30s, the early to mid 30s, and the 70s, they had been reprinted time and time again, and other authors, because sadly Robert E. Howard took his own life at the age of 30, continued on and wrote more Conan stories. And so there was always a Conan fandom, but it did seem to explode a little bit in the 70s with both the Conan the Barbarian comic and then, of course, with Savage Sword. And then there's a lot of argument that it was really the launch of Savage Sword and the success of it that propelled the studios and Dino De Laurentiis to make the 82 movie. And then that was successful. So of course we're going to get a sequel, and then you get one arguably bad sequel and another one that's a very loose adaptation in Red Sonja. And then following that, we get the movie that we don't talk about, that was made again. And which actually, man, as much as I hate to compliment that film, it actually has a better Conan in it than Schwarzenegger's Conan, because Conan himself, and I do want to hop up on my soapbox briefly, Conan is one of the most misunderstood characters. Most people, they think, oh, he's a barbarian and he's dumb. No, Conan, as that little quote that I read, he has gigantic melancholies and gigantic mirth with sullen eyes. He's extraordinarily intelligent. And one of the things I love most about this story, and as we did get into it, is you see that, yes, he's a savage and his responses are very extreme, but only when he comes to the ire. Most all the other times he's very, he stands back and he absorbs and analyzes before he acts. But in a setting, if he feels he's infringed upon or attacked, then he will lash out. And he's very vicious when he attacks that. He's almost in that regard like a wild animal. And I think that's the aspect that people often focus on, which is a shame because they're missing all of the deep analytical stuff that's going on. And you can see that throughout this story. And that's why it's my favorite Conan tale. Robert E. Howard builds this character up from nothing. And by the end of it, and I don't want to spoil anything. We'll get to that, and I'll cover it a little bit at the end. But it's an amazing story, in so much as there really is no protagonist. There is no antagonist. It breaks multiple literary rules. It is structured in three acts, but they are not the three acts that you are used to. You have an introduction. You have kind of a middle, that offers you a passing of the torch from one character to another. And then you have a third act that is built around arguably one action, but that one action is not so much about the action as it is the character that's doing the action, because it's counterintuitive. And at the end of it, you have a character that has grown immensely and yet attained nothing. And I think that is Robert E. Howard's most fantastic legacy in the story. Is it's something that's so engaging, and yet from the beginning to the end, the character gains nothing other than growth in your own mind. But moving on from that, if we can ever so briefly, so when Savage, when this was launched, obviously this was not the first story that Roy Thomas told. He waited 24 issues. But he did, this was important to him. And the reason we know that it is important to him is because he added this, which is a special editorial note. And he does say that it references something special, very special for ye editor writer, Roy Thomas. And it's probably the first and only time it'll be drawn from one artist, it'll be illustrated by a second artist. That first artist for the comic from 1971 was Barry Windsor Smith. And the reason that he could afford or couldn't get John Buscema was because they weren't giving him very much money. And so he got a young Barry Windsor Smith, and Barry Windsor Smith went on to cut his teeth on Conan the Barbarian and become the man we all know today. And thank God for it. Mm-hmm. And now, since one of the things I like to do on the gutter is talk a little bit about affordability of these issues, you are not going to come across anything higher than like a low reader grade of this particular book for anything less than like 20. This is actually a very high demand. It really, anything under 10 on the Conan the Barbarian run is really, it's going to be 20 to 25 in a low quality. Savage Sword 24, something totally different. This is extremely affordable. Even in a nice reader copy, you're looking at like $10. And even online with shipping, you shouldn't be paying more than like 15 to 20 for a reader grade. If you want to get into the higher grades, it gets astronomical. This is a book that collectors look for. Mainly what collectors look for is a pristine cover. Everybody loves the Earl Norum cover because, well, it's an Earl Norum cover. Mm-hmm. And it's Savage Sword. Savage Swords are renowned for how awesome their covers are. And Hostman's Lounge is just 20, as in $20 or 20K. No, you can get this book for $20. It's going to be in like a 3.5, maybe a 4.5 condition. It's a reader copy, a high grade reader copy. $20 shipped to you shouldn't be a problem. I've seen it for like 10 in like a low 3. But if you want a copy, you can get one. You just got to be patient and look a little bit. Don't jump.
Is there a second chance campaign on that?
Yeah, no. No, there's no second chance campaign. Savage, like I said, the Savage Sword issue 24 is much easily attainable. You can also get this in multiple collections. It's been reprinted a couple times. I think it was Conan Saga or something that reprinted a bunch of the Savage Swords. So it's out there. You can get it. But taking a step back even from that, let's talk about the people that were involved in this. You've got Roy Thomas. This is the only man that is ever allowed to talk about I can write Conan. He's the only guy that can bring across, in comics at least, that sense of what Robert E. Howard was able to bring across in his prose. From Conan the Barbarian to Savage Sword, he exudes an appreciation and it, just a beautiful homage to the works of Robert E. Howard. And I will always credit the man that, because every adaptation of every story that he's done has been absolutely fantastic. The pencil work on this issue Again, Savage Sword 24 was done by the infamous John Buscema, as previously mentioned. Sadly, we did lose John. Big John passed away in 2002. His inking on this is of specific note, and you will hear a lot of comments and a lot of compliments to this man. Alfredo Acala, probably the best Filipino artist to come out of the Filipino invasion of the early 70s. Man, this guy is something else. There's a famous story. I'm not going to bore everybody with it. Joe Orlando told him, like, oh, my God, I need to get you at DC. What's your page? Like, how many pages can you do a week? And Alfredo didn't even think about it. He just said 40. And Orlando stepped back and went, no. Like, I need penciled, inked, and lettered pages. Like, how many can you make? Because at the time, like, even the fastest good guys at DC were doing 10. And Alfredo kind of thought about it for a minute and shrugged and said, yeah, 40. And he actually delivered. He could do 30 to 40 pages a week, and they would be exceptional. He rose to the attention, and the reason I'm mentioning this is just because it's absolutely epic. If you ever get a chance, check it out. It's a Filipino comic, Voltar. Voltar is a Viking epic that was started as a comic strip, and then it moved into a comic book in the Philippines. This was, it put Alfredo Acala on the map in both the Philippines because he created his own company around this and it sold exceptionally well. And it got the attention of everybody in the West, and then he drifted over. His talents were absolutely wasted here by the main two. They mostly had him on inking and fill-in duties. But all of these gentlemen from Buscema, from Acala, they were all inspired by comic strips, the work of Hal Foster, the work of Alex Raymond. Those really inspired these guys, and it comes across in all of their work. The attention to detail, the understanding of blacks, the understanding of line weights. You will see that throughout the pages that we will show you tonight. And I feel like this is something that was lost, because those comic strip artists of the 20s, the 30s, and the 40s had something special. And we've talked about it before, whether it was with the Hal Foster episode with Odin Dasko, whether it was with the Jack Kirby episode with Jason Sandberg, or whether it was just some of the other times that we've harkened back to this. The gentlemen that were inspired by that seemed to bring a different power to their work and a different attention to detail and professionalism than the stuff that you see even into the 80s, and especially what you see after the Image Revolution or leading up to the Image Revolution in the 90s. It's a different appreciation for the art form. Whether it's good or bad, that's up to you, because it's art. But I will say this, on the technical side of things, I feel that everything you're about to see tonight is superior to almost everything that we've seen in the post-Image Revolution. So opening up the book to finally get to it 30 minutes into the show, and I apologize for that, you get this absolutely stunningly beautiful intro as a prologue of establishing the tone of the city. And this, I think, and you're going to hear this a lot, Buscema's style when it comes to the art of the form of a person is very fluid, and it's just, it's gorgeous. But what Alcala does is he adds this beautiful line weight to it. And it's the understanding of a strip inker to it. And that's why you see this wonderful weight about the page. Also, I really like the layout. It normally is something that doesn't work for me, but here it works really well. And now I want to turn it over to you guys, because I feel like I've dominated the floor a little bit. And we've got two pages of prologue here. We've got this one and then the following page. And before we get into a little bit of the story, do you guys have any comments or opinions, I guess?
JP, do you want to go first? I'm the guest.
No, I'll defer until we're talking about the story.
Well, I just want to say that the narration in this comic book is, I believe it's Robert E. Howard's, like, straight word for word. Just the way that he opened it up, and the way I think that Roy Thomas paid tribute to him by using it, was just executed perfectly. And Robert E. Howard, he had a way of writing that it kind of was, he gave like a perspective from like a cameraman's view. So it translated to this particular comic very well. And because Roy Thomas is a genius and he knew what he was doing. But this prologue, this opening is just such an amazing opening for a story. It's just written so beautifully. Torches flare murkily on the revels in the mall where the thieves of the East hold carnival by night. Like when you read it, you just get into it and you are immersed into the world. And of course, the artwork is just absolutely stunning. It's gorgeous. So,
oh, for sure. If I could pause you there, I do want to talk a little bit about this. So this is the Hyborian map, the Hyborian Age of Conan, as drawn by Robert E. Howard. Mm-hmm. For a little bit better of one, I delved into the dangerous alleyways of the role-playing game community and found this. Which is a little bit nicer of a map, shows you a little bit of what the world looked like. Again, this is the Hyborian Age. This is after the oceans drank Atlantis. It's a darker age. You can see kind of the general outline of continents and what we would consider. It's supposed to be like the pre-antediluvian world, so to speak. And realms of note, Aquilonia is up here. You'll hear that mentioned probably more than once. Chimeria, where Conan hails from, is to the north of Aquilonia. Anybody that reads the books, if you know where Stygia comes up, if you notice, you've got Shem, which is the plains of Shem that were mentioned in my intro that I quoted from, is right above that. Above that is Koth. Koth will come up here very quickly. Mm-hmm. And then where we are at, where this story is set, is in Zamora, which is over mm-hmm. here. So that just gives you a kind of a geographical context for where things are and where this world is, because this is an actual defined world. While the stories were dropped chronologically out of context and out of place, Robert E. Howard is very aware of what his world is and is, you know, keeps things referential for the most part, fairly grounded in his world. But again, we've got these two beautiful pages that set up the city, and it's the city of thieves. And they're in a particular realm of the city, the mall of the city, where the guards don't pay attention because they're paid off. And the people just kind of run the show. And you get this initially, this raucous bar. And there's a Kothian slaver, this large, bald, thinning hair man. And he's offensive. And he's talking about this and he's talking about that. And he says, oh, you know, I would sell the slave women for, you know, the jewel of the Tower of the Elephant. And you get this great hand emerging from the left side, and it grabs his shoulder and says, you know, he asks a question. And then it leads in to this, which is an epic, epic opening title page. Again, Alcala's inks are just absolutely fantastic. Buscema's form work here is great. And it's the mop of the hair. It's the sullen face that you get for Conan. This is Conan. He is stern, but just aware. And he's lean. And he's not super muscular. He's lean and tall. And he just asks, like, you know, what is this tower? I don't understand it. And as they go back and forth, you get this great, he feels insulted because the Kothian says something and everybody laughs. And, you know, he says, well, there's always, you know, and I love this line because this is such a Conan line. There is always a way if the desire be coupled with courage. And the Kothian takes that as an insult because he says there's no way into the tower. And he affronts Conan. He touches him. And so now we've got a fight. And then that fight extends into the brawl. The candle gets knocked over. You're bathed into darkness. By the time the candle is relit, Conan is gone, but the Kothian is dead. And that's kind of the beginning. This is act one of the story. We have everything. The table has been set. We know about the Tower of the Elephant. It sits in the center of town. There's a wall around it. There are guards. Yara, the evil sorcerer, resides within. But there's a jewel, the jewel of the elephants there. And Conan goes to find out what it is. He sheds everything. So as far as a story introduction, commentary, thoughts.
Can I pontificate on that for a moment?
Absolutely. And,
you know, You all know this story way better than I do. I've only had a first glance. So what I'm about to say, please, please consider it a question. But what I got out of this introduction to the story was that it was really introducing the reader to the concept of savagery in the sense that you could take the events that just happened and you could turn them around and tell the exact same story, and Conan is the antagonist, or you know what I mean? Like the story is obviously about him, but he's, you know, an unconventional protagonist. But if you think about the events that just transpired, you could imagine a story about from that guy's perspective, where this invader comes into town, doesn't know the customs, puts his hand on you, you put your hand on him, and he kills you. That's a villain, right? And so I think it sets up the idea of an inverted or non-existent morality. Hence the idea of it being, you know, setting up that savage world. Am I completely off base, or do you understand?
No. I think you're right on here.
You're on it.
Yeah. Everything that's being done here is to, because again, I want to go back to this. This is the third Conan story, but this is the first where he isn't a king. In Phoenix and the Sword and the Scarlet Citadel, he is already a king. In the Phoenix and the Sword, the people of Aquilonia, there's this small cadre that are rebels, and they rebel against him. And you get a little bit of the spirit realm in that story. And then in the Scarlet Citadel, he's fighting a war, and he gets captured, and he has to escape. And it's a different form. You see leadership. You see a mature Conan. You see him measuring his words. Here, he's a young man. He's, like I said, he's in his late teens, early 20s. He still has a measure about him, but he's being a little bit more brash with how he handles himself. And all it takes is a man that feels slighted by his comment that implies that he is craven for him to be touched. And then that mere touch, which is something that you don't see. In fact, in Phoenix and the Sword, despite having a dirk thrust at him by the bard of his court, he loves the bard because he likes his songs. He doesn't go for a killing blow. He just goes to disarm. Yet here, the young Conan lashes out and immediately kills the man. It's showing you a different Conan. He's a younger Conan and an experienced Conan, but the morality remains the same. And it's the morality of the Cimmerian. It's not the morality of this urban world where the Kothian slaves, because he is established, he's a slaver. And the other thing that I love about the way that Howard constructs something and the way that Thomas phrases it when he goes about it is the Kothian is a female slaver. He's selling female slaves, but he's selling them to the Zamorians, who knew more about female slavery than he could ever teach them. Yet he's still there, which tells you that not only is he a scumbag, but he's a scumbag in a city of scumbags. Mm-hmm. And he's on the lower end. He's like a low rent pimp in Vegas. It's, you know, everybody around him does this better, but he's in a bar bragging about how he does it so well. But he's in a bar in the not good part of town. So all it does is establish that he is the scum of the earth. So it does exactly that. It's a beautiful set piece. And then before we move on, I do want to, you know, comment the chat here a little bit. Hojo says, Buscema is my Conan guy. Well, yeah, he's a lot of people's Conan guy. As is Barry Windsor Smith. It really depends on where you entered into this world. Henry Bemis says Buscema's Conan ruled. It did. Buscema really seemed to find his footing. I know there's a lot of Buscema fans that love his Avengers run. But to me, man, he did like 150 issues of Conan. And this is his realm, man. Like everything about him from his... Like I said, that fluidity of style. And he's had a lot of anchors. And when you go through Savage Sword, there's a lot of issues of Savage Sword where you're peering through bad inking at beautiful John art. And you feel bad for him because they just hired a bad anchor. But with Alcala, especially on this one, oh my gosh, man. Just chef's kiss. It's a perfect blend. Nobody inks John Buscema like Alfredo Acala. Nobody inks like Alfredo Acala, but I mean, Art T-Bear might come close today. But man, this guy was an expert inker. He knew when to use the brush. He knew when to use the line. He knew when to use the line weight. Page after page tonight that we're going to be showing you is just a goddamn testament to his skill. And it should serve as, you could just use this book as a lesson for an inker. But moving through a little bit, we got image focused on story and quotas. It gave us comics like Invincible, really loose line art, but a good story and a decent cover to sell you. Arguably, that's Generation 3 image by the time you're talking about Invincible. I'm talking about the Image Revolution, which is late, pre-Image, so late 80s, early 90s. Image's drop, early 90s, and then when Image crashed, which was mid-90s. That's the era I'm talking about. You're not even talking loose line art. We're talking Rob Liefeld, no feet. We're talking stories that are completely incomprehensible by issue 3. It's all of that. It's Jim Lee's X-Men run, which took, you know, Chris Claremont's 20-plus year run and condensed it down into, like, what, 17 issues? Kayla would be able to correct me on that. But it was ridiculous. It was ridiculous in its understanding of what storytelling meant and what storytelling meant to comics. It's when art became the only thing that we worry about. And the minute that happens, you lose any traction because people will buy one issue for art. They will buy hundreds of issues for story, as shown by Savage Sword, Uncanny X-Men, and on and on and on. But Aldous braved the dark recesses of RPG gaming fandom to bring us this map. Yes, many Bothans died to bring us that map. It was terrible. Snuggy Jr. reminds you that antediluvian means before the flood, for those of you that weren't up on your 50-cent words. Dana Marie has joined us. Great to see Dana Marie. Thank you, sir. And Citizen Ronan asked Snuggy Jr. what was it like posing for this page? Oh, it's getting a little warm in the chat, it seems like. People are getting a little friendly. A killing blow. That's ambitious. There we go. And Philbo Baggins. Ernie Chan was great as well. Absolutely. No argument there. And with that said, I'm sorry, Kayla, go ahead.
Well, I just wanted to say something when you were talking about story. Okay. So Robert E. Howard was a master of story. And Roy Thomas, though, what he understood that what Robert E. Howard did was that each story has to have a moral core to it in an aspect. Like there is a moral core to this story, I feel, and a couple of different themes that lie within it. And this story has a proper ending, which doesn't happen in many comics. I mean, for granted, he had a great person that he was inspired by and that is the heart and soul of this book to work off of. And it just broke so many different rules. But that is because, like we were discussing before the show, the story is through Conan's eyes. So.
Right, and I think it's one of the most important things to talk about when it comes to Savage Sword, and you're talking about Conan in general. Almost every issue of Savage Sword is a complete standalone. It very rarely references anything that happened before it, other than lightly contextually. And it always ends. You can pick up any issue, read it, and get a great story. Also, you can start at the beginning and read through it, and it's absolutely amazing.
Yes.
And that's the way a good comic should be. There should be no good entry point. You just say, dude, just grab a copy. It doesn't matter. Just grab a copy. Conan's that way. You can pick up any of these, and they're amazing. And you never need to have read any of the original Robert E. Howard books. You didn't need to read all of the novels that have been done by two-bit, half-wit, and, you know, half-assed authors since then. You don't need to read the original Conan the Barbarian comics. You can just pick up an issue and it's good. And that's, in my opinion, what I look for. That's what I think most people look for, is just, I just want to grab something. And if it's good, I enjoy it.
Yeah.
Does it help that they're magazine sized and all the art's oversized and it's awesome? Absolutely.
Oh, yes.
Does it help that it's in black and white?
Yes.
I think so. I think black and white's a much more, I think it leaves a little bit to the imagination, personally.
Well, that kind of bums me out because one of my questions was, do we ever see Taurus in any other works? Because that dude was awesome.
Okay, so that's a perfect lead-in, right? Because we've got the Kothian dies. The Kothian slaver's dead. And Conan sheds his tunic and marches straight. Because, again, this is a young Conan. He was just challenged. Nobody can go to the Tower of the Elephant. Well, I will do it, damn you. And he goes. And he goes right to the Tower of the Elephant. And, again, beautiful work here on both Buscema and Alcala. And he gets there, and he hops over the wall, and he meets Taurus.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Taurus of Nemedia, the Prince of Thieves, right? This is the first time that you see Conan a little taken back in the story because he recognizes the name.
Mm-hmm.
And so they both climb over. They snuck into the grounds. Now they're climbing over the main wall. And they enter the garden that's around the base of the tower. And as they sneak in, they come upon lions. And this is the first moment Conan raises his sword and Taurus puts his hand on him and says, no, 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 I've got this. And this is an epic moment. He puts a little blow dart or blow tube up and blows out this dust and all the lions fall dead. And when they fall dead, Conan's shocked. And then Taurus reads out, and it's not done to nearly the degree in this adaptation that it is in the book, but he reads out this epic journey that he had to go to Stygia and steal from a serpent this dust. Mm-hmm. And it's a story that would make an amazing book in and of itself that's recounted in like a paragraph. And it builds that aura that, yes, you want to know more about this guy because Conan recognizes him. Conan's young. Again, he's only been outside of Samaria for so long, but he recognized this is a man who in Conan's time, if you go back to Phoenix and the Sword, if you go back to Scarlet Citadel, that's Conan's reputation. And they invert it here in that Conan is meeting somebody that's just as famous as he someday will be, in that even a lowly Samarian in the City of Thieves meets the Prince of Thieves and goes, oh my God, I've heard of you. And the Prince of Thieves also gives a little bit of that nod of respect that he already admires Conan, that he's gone this far and he's this aware and he's heard of him, that he allows him to accompany him. And he's protecting him by protecting him from the lions. Comments from both of you.
Okay. So what you're saying kind of reinforces that there's courage and honor amongst thieves, that saying. On page 13, there was something that stuck with me the more I looked at it. There was the second to last panel. And I felt that it is very reflective of certain things to come. So Conan, he says, but I see no light. And Taurus's response speaks, it pretty much says that there are cleverly constructed doors and windows, but they are closed. The soldiers breathe air that comes from above. So to me, like, because I try to look into deeper symbolism of things, it's in a way an element of the story that's reflecting Conan's mind state, okay? And it also tells us about future events and how it's going to change him. It's going to unlock something in his mind, change his perception. He will no longer be in the dark. It also is going to open his heart, because if you think of a heart being guarded, constructed doors. And in an aspect, it's going to change how he lives his life, because the air element is key to the other three elements. So that's just, I know it's very odd, but it's how I see things. Also, with the lions being in the book, there's five of them. Five is a number of like conflict, change, and challenges. So I feel like that is symbolism as well. And I think it's representative of pride and the death of the lions. And here Conan is having to work with someone. It also, to me, speaks about his future travels and his future as a king. And the narration in it, where it's it says like man and beast go down together, and I think basically that line there, man and beast, define what a barbarian is in an aspect, or how a barbarian is perceived, because an uncivilized man could be called a beast because a beast is not really considered gentle and behaves savagely. So, yeah, just some random thoughts. But
no, all good and all well appreciated. Henry Bemis says that center panel of them sneaking over the wall was totally swiped by Milius for the 92 movie. I'm not going to argue with that. There is a lot from Savage Sword that you will see utilized, especially, and Tower of the Elephant, for the initial sequence, for those of you that are vaguely familiar with the movie, the scene where they go in to steal the jewel and they meet, I can't remember her name, just had a mind wipe and I can't, but when they go into the tower, that is Tower of the Elephant. They're stealing or borrowing from that story to go in and get the jewel. And then they come out. That's the Tower of the Elephant portion. And absolutely it was borrowed from this. And this is going to be a longer episode because we are now at the 1 hour mark and we are one third of the way through the book. So
what do we expect though? I like to talk. You like to talk. JP.
Excellent observation there. Henry Bemis. But yeah, so moving forward, we are, so he takes down the lions and there is one more lion that shows up and Conan takes care of it and earns more respect from Taurus. And then they throw up a line and they climb up the side of the tower. And this I loved. And I know Kayla, you mentioned this as well, yes. But they get to the top of the tower and Conan is absolutely enthralled with the amount of jewels that are encrusting the top of the tower. And he says, mm-hmm. You know, there must be a fortune here. And you know, ignore them. You know, you fool. There's more inside. You know, we need the top. We need the jewel of the elephant. That's what we came here for. And it's just this, this great, like it's the greed aspect to a degree. Cause they're, mm-hmm. again, he's the Numidia is the prince of thieves. Taurus of Numidia is the prince of thieves, but also Conan is a thief. And that's the aspect of Conan that is so often forgotten, is that he's a thief. He's a thief. He's a reaver. These are things that are core to his character. And then here we get the other lion appearance, and then we go back up. And I had those pages flipped. I apologize. And then we go to this, and we see into the chamber, mm-hmm. and Taurus tells Conan, no, you wait here and keep your eye out and, you know, I'll enter. And Taurus sneaks in. Now, up till now, Taurus has, he saved Conan's ass when it came to the lions. He has a tale over how he got the powder from the lotus flower snuck into the caravan in Stygia and stole it right from beneath the serpent's mouth. And then the rope that will maintain three times his weight was stolen from, I can't remember where the corpses,
the hairs of dead ladies. And
yeah. And then, yeah. You know, steeped in this, and like, he's been preparing for this, everything, like he is prepared. Right. He tells Conan to wait and he sneaks into the room and he hears this awful sound and Conan turns and he sees Taurus of Numidia, the prince of thieves, fall flat up before him, dead. And it's a moment of shock for Conan. And it's so beautifully rendered here with the art. You get that sense of just absolute shock. Because again, everything's been building up that this is somebody, and boom, we're dead. And now what we're doing is we're passing the torch in storytelling, right? Yeah. Step one, act one, established in the mall of the city, we've established who Conan is. Now we've associated Conan with a character that he respects, that is known. We've established that character has had immense travels and immense experiences, and we've built him up, and now we kill him in a Paragon-esque fall so that Conan can now rise into this role. And as Conan turns the body, he sees three marks on the shoulder. And I love, like, you talk mm-hmm. about great panel layouts. It doesn't get any better than those last two. You see Conan's prepared to go in, and then you just focus in on his eyes.
Gorgeous.
And then it's page turn. And from here, arguably, I would say that this is the end of the second act of the story. Yeah. We've got the first act, we establish the hero. The second act, we merge, we associate the hero with someone that's known that has tales of wondrous deeds. And we build them up, and then they fall, and now the hero is going to rise. So I guess thoughts up to this point before we actually enter, because up to this point, we are just now entering the Tower of the Elephant.
Okay. So obviously the second chapter of this story or act, it's a heist. All right. So I want to focus on what I was talking to you about how Conan pretty much, he's mesmerized by the jewels. He's tempted by the jewels, and he's saying in one of the panels how there is just this fabulous fortune. But in the end, the jewel he seeks is not one he can keep. And I'll leave it at that for anyone that hasn't read the story, because we will get there, because we're entering the third act. Other than that, this is just absolutely gorgeous artwork to look at. So it's just beautiful. I don't want to talk too much because I can talk a lot about this. Should have started earlier. But yeah. JP?
Yeah, I was mesmerized by those last two panels and how
they're gorgeous.
He somehow captured Conan's dirty ass hair.
What?
Look, he's got greasy hair. What am I, crazy?
No, it's healthy. It's lustrous.
No, it's, I mean, yeah, it can be that, but it's also clearly greasy. It's reflecting light in a dark room.
Oh, Lord.
Did we lose Aldous?
I don't know. Aldous. Oh, wait, hold on. Hold on. Oh, okay. So. All right.
You know, until Aldous comes back, I got to point out, Awesome One has been lighting it up in the chat with some mm-hmm. with some bangers for comments. Can I do this? Shouldn't have had that Taco Bell before a fight. He meets Captain Crunch to his astonishment. Snuggy Jr., Conan needs some herbal essence.
Oh my God.
Check all this for 3 marks.
Oh, Lord.
Conan's hair is greasier than mine when I don't cut it. Hey, yeah, that reminds me. Is it Conan or Conan?
Conan.
Okay. I think that is the most beginner question I could possibly ask. Need you guys to hold it down. Okay. Aldous will be back in a few minutes. So I'm taking over.
Like the narration in the story, it's so good because Roy Thomas translated everything so beautifully, and he really showed how Howard was a master of prose without quoting him at length. You know, it's just everything runs so fluid and everything is so poetic, and you are really engaged and invested into the story. And it just, in a way too, like I said, and what always astounds me is how he breaks every rule possible. Like the story breaks every rule possible when you think about writing.
Mm.
Because we're not introduced. So every protagonist needs an antagonist, right? To oppose them. And this story kind of violates this in an aspect. But that's because this is not, Conan actually is not our protagonist.
And that was another thing that I had been thinking about, is that in a savage world, the world can be the antagonist. Does that make sense?
I mean, this story alone, basically gives you everything that you need to know about the world of Conan. It really shows you all about the world building. It talks about everything structurally. I feel like it sets everything up for you. It's interesting to me too, how none of these were like the order that they were released in as well. So whereas this is like an earlier story, but where the first Conan story, he's a king, but this is technically like the first story.
You mean canonically there's no baby Conan stories?
There are not any baby Conan stories. And to everyone's reassurance, I do not have three marks on my back, so I appreciate the concern. I do apologize for that. I don't have a problem with the show running long. The puppy did. So the puppy's on a very strict schedule and was very upset.
The spider got to him.
Puppy's cute.
So yes, she is. But yeah, so, and I think what you mentioned there was very important, is that, you know, this is not, it does violate all the rules, like we talked about. It doesn't establish, you're about to meet your protagonist, and we're in Act 3. Everything up till now has been Conan. And as we move into the tower, the first thing you get is this it's you thought the wealth on the outside was something. The wealth on the inside is just something entirely of a different level. And Conan is shocked at the expanse, at the wealth that's here. It is absolutely amazing. And then, but he's on his guard because he knows that something has come. He knows that something took out Taurus of Numidia, the prince of thieves, who, while described as plump and slightly rotund, is still extraordinarily agile and intelligent. But he was struck down by this beast of an arachnid, this black spider of death that comes around. And it's not the spider itself that's really the threat. It's its web as you get into it. And it's intelligent. It's able to read Conan. And Conan knows that as this thing is coming at him, it can't come at him directly. He is too fast for it. And so it starts being crafty, and it starts weaving its webs and throwing its web around. And he knows that he can't get his blade or any part of his body touched by this. And so Conan, he uses the brutality of the savage and picks up a giant chest, the one thing the spider wouldn't expect, and smashes the chest into the spider.
I have to jump in really quick because I have not laughed so hard at something that was not even remotely intended to be funny as the way that chest just pummels that goddamn spider. look at that. Like, the Mike and Ike's going everywhere. Good God, that's such a great panel.
No, and this is where everything really settles down into the action beats and the understanding. There's no background in this. You'll see a lot of times where Buscema will do backgrounds, and the backgrounds are extraordinarily detailed and exceptional. But it's the inking. It's everything else about this other than the background that sell it as just the action. The action is what matters. And I think that's... Go ahead, Kayla.
Oh, no, I'm just saying, I just think it's so amazing how they were able to basically retain the story's prose while using, I don't know, would this be the Marvel method, you would assume? Or, like, this is probably a little bit more than the Marvel method. And basically, the art, it's enhancing the story with supporting visuals, and just the dialogue is great, and all of the descriptive text and narration and prose. And it's just, I think this is the best adaptation of this story because the creator knew what to do in order to basically have like a transition that could be considered workable in this type of medium.
Oh, for sure. No, I completely get what you're saying. It's I think a lot of it's just Roy Thomas understanding. I mean, at this point, he's been involved in Marvel Comics for over a decade. He understands what they're looking for. He understands what story is. This means a lot to Roy. This is Roy's passion project. He never dreamed when he started Conan the Barbarian that he would get to do Savage Sword. This is something that, because of the success of Conan the Barbarian, that previous series, which that series ran for 275 issues from, gosh, what was it, 70, I think 70 to 90. It was just an immensely long run, very successful, and launched the careers of, like I said, Barry Windsor Smith, amongst many others. So you're talking about a book series that wasn't just expansive, but very successful. And this isn't his first. Roy was also famously involved in X-Men and numerous other Marvel properties. So when you're looking at this, you're looking at something that is done by somebody that has the experience, that understands that storytelling structure, that is definitely, definitely involved and gets what he wants to do. And you're seeing that time and time again, page to page.
It's also interesting too. He's a thief, and they make it a point to talk about how he's never seen so many riches like before this evening, and especially in a place like this, and how quick he is to basically toss that treasure box at that spider like that. And he doesn't take anything. He does not take a damn thing in this area with all these jewels and gold and everything. So just a point.
No, and a very apt point as well.
It says something about his character in a way. So
absolutely. And moving on a little bit into the story. So now with the Guardian gone,
we go into the third act, and this is where it gets all Lovecraftian and everything.
Yes. So he descends the stairway and he meets Yag-Kosh. And Yag-Kosh is arguably, if you're going to have a protagonist in the story, it is Yag-Kosh. Mm-hmm. And Kayla, I would love, I have to step away briefly, so I'd love to hear your take on this, because I know you've got some notes on it. So could you talk a little bit about what Yag-Kosh, actually, you know what, let's go to JP real quick. JP, what was your take first seeing this? Because Yag-Kosh is an amazing character within the Conan realm, because this is the first time that we're going to take this world beyond into the ether. It's very Lovecraftian, and I hate that word, as everybody knows, but it is where it's heading, because what Yag-Kosh is about to describe is something that is noteworthy. It's something that's it expands the world beyond just that map that we saw earlier that Howard had established. This is now galactic. It's now, you know, universal in its sense. So did you take anything away from that? And I will be right back.
I mean, I'm excited to hear what Kayla has to say about it, but this was kind of the point of the story where I began to sense that there was a lot more to this world that I didn't have any understanding of. So I'm probably the last person in the world to ask to expand upon the meaning of the character, other than his proportions, man. That's got to be rough. Like, his neck muscles must be out of control.
Are you talking about Yag-Kosh?
Yeah. So, he's like a candy apple.
So, how? Like, I don't even know where to begin without all this to guide me here, because I have to kind of rein myself in. Plus, we're
well. Not. Does the character show up elsewhere, or is this well, it?
In an aspect, I think Yag-Kosh reflects Robert E. Howard. In an aspect, it helps you gain insight into something about him, that the character is kind of him, in an aspect. If that makes any sense, just because it's kind of like, how can I put it? I'm trying to think because we're not further enough where I want to say what I want to say. But I think like there is an aspect to Howard, and we know that he died at 30 and everything, but he, it seemed that in certain things that were expressed, like he could not connect well with others, especially when he was living in Texas or with his Texas life and the lifestyle there. And he kind of, it seemed possibly maybe he felt imprisoned or as otherworldly as Yakov. So.
Oh, is this true here, what Hostman says? You're allowed to use Lovecraftian if the author of the story was friends with the man?
I mean, think it is.
Because I know it would bother out Aldous.
It is permitted, but yeah, it's still, it's so abused. And then granted, I mean, yes, you are talking about a man that was of the era with Lovecraft. So
I mean, the Weird Tales, they had imagine getting this Weird Tales where there's a Conan story and a Lovecraft story in it.
Well, and imagine that on top of a Margaret Brundage cover. I mean, this is an era, and I hate to do this because everybody always like, Aldous likes this pulp stuff. Like you guys said on this week on Joe's show, like, oh yeah, shocker, Aldous doesn't like the Image shit. There's an era that I love, and it is this. And man, this stuff is so magical, and it's a goddamn shame that it isn't appreciated or read more, because it is something that is just totally unique. But moving on, we get the introduction of Yag Kosh, and he does tell the story of his people and particular. Now, and as we get into this, you'll see immediately the panels change. And as we get the story of what Yag Kosh went through, we get this more fluid. Everything up till now has been very structured. We are now drifting to a very fluid panel layout for that bottom third of the page. And it's going to be this very magical, very ethereal style. It's floating because it's a tale that is told. And we get this epic story on everything that Yag Kosh has gone through. And Conan sits there and he listens to it. And it is just absolutely fantastic as we go through. And you hear the story of how Yag Kosh recognizes that, Conan's different than Yara. Yara is the sorcerer. Yara is the imprisoner. For three centuries, Yara has tortured and abused Yag Kosh and, utilized his power. The tower that we are currently in went up in a single night because Yara forced Yag Kosh to do this. He's an alien. He's exiled to Earth. His wings that allowed him to come burned up in the atmosphere as he entered the Earth, and he's been trapped here since. And initially, he trusted Yara, and Yara abused that trust and imprisoned him. And for, again, three centuries, Yag Kosh has sat on this throne and been tortured and abused to do Yara's bidding. And all he wants is revenge. And this is a theme that will come time and time again. Revenge, vengeance are themes that are overarching throughout all of Conan's stuff. But again, here, it's not Conan's vengeance. Conan is the listener. He's passive. Mm-hmm. He's exterior to all of this. He's young, but he's seeing this. And this is opening the Sumerian's mind into that there's a larger world. And there are things that are more important than the things that he values right now. There are things that sometimes it's okay just to do the right thing. And that's that as this extends out, you get the full story and then it delves into Yara. And again, these beautiful, absolutely epic inks by Alcala. The simple choices of just doing that heavy brush line around all the panels is so fantastic. And again, it gets into that where I've talked a lot. I don't like the white space between the panels, but here it works because of that heavy black line. And you get those gutters actually have weight.
Mm-hmm.
And then as we move in further to the story.
Before we move in further, now I can make my comments that I was waiting for you to get to like a certain point and show that stuff. So there was something that it like was conveyed to me when I was rereading this today, actually. In the narration, which I have my copy on my lap, let me get to the right page. Sorry, 28. On page 28, there's a sense of emotional turmoil in the narration where it's basically, it states here, he senses only that he is looking upon a cosmic tragedy, and he shrinks with shame as if the guilt of a whole race were laid upon him. At last, the creature sighs. So this narration here, in the way that Buscema also draws Conan, which it seems that Conan is embarrassed or ashamed and feels all of this guilt for the human race, for how this creature has been treated by people, and just the shift of emotions from the panels where we came in on page 28 to that last panel. And it touched me because we think of Conan as being so one-dimensional, and that he's this fearsome barbarian. We also get the idea too about his feeling of the supernatural. He has a fear of the supernatural. It's stated at the very beginning of the page too. So it's something he hasn't experienced or seen before. There's something about everything that shows his defense being broken down. And then as Yakosh is telling his story, so basically this whole point really serves to flesh out the lore and like a lot of the history with things, I think. And all of this here adds like a crap ton of emotional value to any of the other stories possibly, if that makes sense. And there's a lot of context within this, if that makes sense as well.
No, I get what you're saying for sure. Eric and Ape as well gets what I'm saying, and says that I feel you all this. Nowadays, people use Lovecraftian to mean my barely disguised technical fetish. Yes, you get my meaning for sure. And Tainted Ewok says, interesting thought by Kayla. Howard, too, was known for looking back into the past that no longer existed. This character, too, is a relic stuck in a different age.
I feel like he wrote himself into Yakosha's character, Robert E. Howard.
Yeah, I don't think you're wrong. I think there's pieces of Howard in both Conan. As a Texan, I think he's definitely giving forth that honor, the old school concept of honor, forth. And at the same time, it's a little bit blended into the past, the heralding of what Yakosh represents. Hostman does also say that Lovecraft wrote an obituary for Howard, which I did not know.
I did not know that either.
Henry Bemis agrees and says, yeah, that panel design is cool. An awesome one says, oh, that's why this show is called The Gutter. Well, everyone ends up here eventually if you read comics. So yes, indeed. That's the double entente of the show, so to speak. But as the story continues, so he tells the story, Yakshath tells the story of how Yara imprisoned him. And then I love this. Actually, I'm going to go back to, is it this page? No, it's this page. I want you to look at panel 3. And this is where I think the change happens, is there are tears coming out of Yakosh's face because he is in immense pain. And Conan, as the savage, right, he stops and he cares. And there is a moment of empathy. Because he sees the marks of the rack that is specifically mentioned. He sees the marks of the rack and he understands what has been done here. And then he sees those tears and he sees it begging for salvation. He sees it begging for forgiveness. And then you move into.
Yeah, see, he had a great pity, like just such a great pity for him. And it's very touching. I find it very, like a very touching moment and the empathy that he's exuding here. You know, and he basically is saying, he's like, I'm not Yara, I'm only a thief. Like, I'm not going to harm you. Which also speaks on his character as Conan's character as well, too. He's not going to harm something that is defenseless.
Right. Well, I love this, because this is the essence of it, is that Yagkash now demands that Conan kill it. And it cut out its heart, and it gives it very specific instructions.
Oh man, this part I was really nervous, because you know he had all these instructions on what to do, and if it were me, I would have probably gotten to step two and been like, "Wait, I was supposed to do what after this? I was supposed to do something." Right. And you can't ask him again. Yeah, you can't ask him again because he's fucking dead.
Right. It's the old, I think that aspect of like second guessing, nothing does it better than Army of Darkness, where Ash is told to pick up the book and say the words, Klaatu Bravada Nikto, and then all will be repaired. And he gets there. He finally gets to the book and he lifts it up and Klaatu Bravada Nickel. Definitely an N word. You don't see that enough, in my opinion, in stuff that sometimes stuff takes itself too seriously. There's a moment for that kind of humor. Riami and Campbell have always done it well. But here, yes, there's definitely that sense of like the instructions aren't complex, but man, like what if you miss and don't do something right? And so Conan strikes true and he kills Yagshoth and he cuts out his heart.
And at that moment, it changes him. It changes.
Oh, for sure. This is a moment of change for the character. This is the evolution. Again, the protagonist of the story, Yagkash, is now dead. Mm-hmm. This is the second Paragon that has now failed. His first was obviously Taurus of Numidia, who perished from the spider. His second is by his own hand. Now Yagkash, this deity from another planet, exiled to our world, has now perished by Conan's hand, but he is now the instrument of vengeance for this all-powerful deity. And again, I love that panel five where he's descending the stairs after he squeezes the heart's blood onto the jewel of the elephant is just exceptional. And it goes to the detail that's in these stories. And he goes down to Yara's room and he confronts Yara and follows through with the instructions. And Yara is miniaturized down and sucked into the gym. And then you see Yagkash in his full glory inside the gym come down and wreak his vengeance upon Yara as Conan watches. And then Conan bolts. He leaves. And as he's running through, he sees all the guards are dead. And he's able to escape outside of the tower. And as he exits the tower with nothing more than he entered it with, the tower collapses. So as a thief, Conan has failed. He exits the Tower of the Elephant. In the very beginning, we established the amount of wealth over and over again. The mystery of the tower, as he climbs the tower, it's the wealth of the jewels. As he looks into the room when he first gets in and before he faces the spider, it's nothing but this immense amount of wealth. But now the tower has collapsed, and he walks away with nothing. Yet
no, he can go pick some stuff up.
Oh no, the tower disappears completely. Mm-hmm. It collapses, then everything disappears.
He'll find it,
and there's nothing left. But he's more. He's more than before when he ever entered this. He is no longer just a man, just a young man. He has gone through this, and he's gained something, and that's, I think, the power of this story. I think that's why I love it so much, is despite the fact that he's gone through all this gauntlet and he comes out with nothing, no tangible asset, this forever changes the character of Conan. He's never that brash man that meets the Kothian slaver again. He has that edge to him, and you'll see moments, brief glimpses of that. But ever thereafter, this moment in Tower of the Elephant, the Conan character is established for what you see after this. This is his maturation. This is his growth. This is his journey to the final destination of manhood, in my opinion. That's why I love this story so much. And I can think of no better adaptation that has ever been done than this one itself. So as we move into a much longer gutter than I ever dreamed of, final thoughts from both of you.
Do I have to go first?
Oh, no, I can say some dumb crap. We didn't get a chance to talk about it, but, you know, one thing that I really took from this is the part where, you know, the spider was slinging ropes of slimy grayish stuff at it and sticky strands were covering the door. You know, that really brought me back to when I was a janitor at that adult bookstore.
What?
What? Awesome One says the tower never existed. And that gets into some existentialism of, does it ever exist? Could it have ever existed? If you go into some of the non-Robert E. Howard writings, there's one that mentions that nobody can remember the tower after it collapses. Nobody remembers Yara. I can't remember who wrote that one, but it was kind of weird and I didn't really dig it. But it's an interesting concept for sure.
Serious final thought, because I kind of pick up on visual cues in my head canon, Yag Kosh was the narrator of the story. Because as he was narrating his story, it looked very similar to the narration of the actual story. So I don't care if it's true or not. In my head, he was talking the entire time.
Read the
book.
I did. All right. I totally did.
No, but you bring up a good point in that without some of the connecting tissue that you've got in the prose version, you could definitely come to that conclusion. But the book, the story is narrated, and you get the impression, at least on a second or third or tertiary read, the impression I get is this is something. It still fits in that older Conan, because it's like Conan, an older Conan is telling this story, and at a certain part, it's like in a movie. It's like in like Hunt for Red October, where everybody's in Russian and suddenly they switch to the really bad like English Russian with a Russian accent that's terrible, but everybody pretends it's good. It's like that. Like it starts off as Conan's narrating a tale that he's telling someone, and then you drift into it like you would a film, and it just becomes its own action piece. At least to me, that's how I've always kind of looked at it. The more readings I get, I kind of get firmer and firmer into that. But Kayla, do you have any final thoughts, overarching thoughts, anything you feel like you didn't have enough time to mention?
I could talk about this forever, but in short, I feel that this is a tale that has a theme of humanness in it and what exactly is humanness. And to me, right?
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that.
To me,
I appreciate that it was noticed.
when we compare the barbarian Conan, right, and this otherworldly creature, Kasha, to the human wizard Yara, we see that it's Yara who is truly the most inhuman and uncivilized of them all. So, that's how.
Very good.
Kayla,
throughout the week you told me you were very nervous for your appearance here for whatever reason, and I do not understand why. There seems to be some sense that like coming on the gutter is like going through some kind of interrogation where JP and I are going to beat you with, you know, a pillowcase full of oranges and a phone book for some reason. That's not the case. Did your experience on the gutter live up to your trepidations throughout the week?
Oh, I loved it. I'm having so much fun. I just think it's nervous because I watch the show all the time and I'm a fan of it. I mean, I know you two, but it's different. I don't want to like
be. I didn't do enough. I'm going to have to be dumber next week.
Fucking bad show. But I mean, all in all, this comic, it's sword and sorcery at its finest. It's like the most original and it's best, I would say. So, yeah. I mean, I just had a lot of fun. I don't know what to say right now.
Oh, I did want to add that if you haven't read this comic while reading or while listening to Mastodon, Blood Mountain, or Clutch Elephant Riders, I recommend both.
Oh, I can't give enough recommendations for Clutch. Man, if you've never seen Clutch live, the next time they come to your town, make sure you get tickets. They put on a hell of a show.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think that's going to do it for this. A slightly longer episode of The Gutter than I anticipated. But from us to you, thank you for joining us. Last words, JP.
Oh, no, I just did like 10 last words.
All right. Last words, Kayla.
I'll be back in the future, more than likely, to talk Dark Phoenix.
Yes. We will be talking Chris Claremont's Dark Phoenix arc at some point, probably early summer. That is coming. We have a wonderful number of guests coming up. Next week, we have Narwhal. Make sure you tune in for that. Until then, this has been The Gutter.
This is blood for blood and part of gallons. This is the old days and the bad days, the all or nothing days. They're back. There's no choices left.
Still here? It's over. Go home.